Hello and welcome to What's in the Night Sky for June 2023. This month we are going to be looking out for Noctilucent Clouds, the planets Mars and Venus putting on a show for us in the evening skies, the Summer Triangle Asterism, and our constellation of the month, which is Cygnus the Swan. Let's begin by taking a look at the evening planets. If we head out shortly after sunset at the beginning of the month and look towards the west, we should be able to see Venus shining brightly. The sun doesn't set until after 9 o'clock during June, so we need to be thinking about heading out at around 10 o'clock. You'll need a nice flat horizon in the west so that you can observe for as long as possible before Venus gets too low. Venus shouldn't be too difficult to spot, but if you fancy more of a challenge, you can have a go at spotting Mars as well. And we can just about see Mars here nestled in the constellation of Cancer. If we zoom in on it, we can see that at the beginning of the month, the red planet actually resides within an open cluster known as the Beehive Cluster. And it will stay there for the first 3 days of the month, roughly. And we can see how Mars makes its journey through the Beehive Cluster at the beginning of the month. The Beehive Cluster is a swarm of around 1,000 stars, approximately 577 light years away from us. And in ideal conditions, in a dark location, you would be able to spot some of them with your naked eye. In this case, you'll need some binoculars to see them because it's really close to sunset and the sky isn't fully dark and it's quite low to the horizon as well. If you sweep around with your binoculars, find Mars and you should then be able to see some of the stars of the Beehive Cluster in your field of view as well at the same time. It will be quite a tricky spot, so it will be even more rewarding if you do manage to find it. If you have a small telescope, you can have a go with a small telescope as well with a low powered eyepiece and see how many of those stars you can pick out. If we stay with Mars and Venus and just follow them over the course of the month, I'm just going to make it a little bit later so that the sky is a bit darker. When you're trying to spot these early evening planets, one of the most important things is to try to be somewhere with a nice flat horizon, otherwise you're really going to struggle. So if we go through the month, you can see that Venus and Mars begin to close in on each other. Venus passes by the Beehive Cluster on around the 12th of the month, so if you didn't manage to see the Beehive with Mars at the beginning of the month, there's another opportunity in the middle to spot Venus first and then see if you can make out any of those stars in the Beehive Cluster. Again, that will be a really tricky spot. You can see that the pair are getting lower as the month goes on, as well as getting closer together, so they become more and more difficult to see because of their proximity to the horizon as we go through the month. And actually, now I need to go a little bit earlier. The thing to do is to go out as soon as you can after sunset and wait for these two to pop out of the evening twilight, and then you can follow them until they set. So if we continue, and the moon passes by on the 21st, 22nd, crescent moon. So if you want to have an opportunity to see the three of these together, this would make quite a nice photograph, I think, then you can do that on the 21st and the 22nd. And then if we keep going all the way to the end of the month, and Venus and Mars make their closest approach to each other on the 30th of June. So if you're still managing to see them above the horizon after sunset on the 30th, then that will be your opportunity to see them as close as possible together. You might even get them into the same field of view of a pair of binoculars. So you can see here I've got some 10 by 50 binoculars, and they would fit nicely into the field of view of those binoculars together. Before we leave the twilight skies, it's worth remembering that this is prime noctilucent cloud season, so don't forget to look out for them in the northern sky 1 to 2 hours after sunset throughout the month. I talked in a bit more detail about noctilucent clouds or night shining clouds in last month's video, so if you want to find out more about them, you can refer back to May's video. Let's take a look now at the planets that are visible in the early morning skies for those of you who like to stay up late or like to rise early. We can have a look at the morning skies. I'm going to go from 2 o'clock in the morning. It's going to take us back to the beginning of the month, and I'm going to move around to the southeast. Okay, so here we are looking towards the southeast around 2 o'clock in the morning, and if I just continue to bring time onwards, we can see that Saturn is rising just after 2 o'clock in the morning, and then you can see the sky brightening as we head towards sunrise, and hopefully we'll see Jupiter pop out of there as well. Okay, here's Jupiter. So you've got Saturn and Jupiter in the early morning skies. Neither of them get very high. Sunrise happens at around 4:50 in the morning at the beginning of June. So there's very little time to observe Jupiter. If we move through the month, you can see that Jupiter gets a little bit higher as the month goes on. And that means that you can observe a little bit earlier when the sky is not quite so bright. So it's another one of those times where you need a nice flat horizon. And you can see that the moon comes to join Jupiter on the 14th, and you get a really close approach of the moon and Jupiter there on the 14th. And if I just put a binocular view on again, you can see you've got lovely crescent moon in Jupiter. You can see Jupiter's Galilean moons in my view here. People have varying degrees of success seeing Jupiter's moons with binoculars. If you've got a reasonably big pair of binoculars, so this is 10 by 50, and a steady hand, you might be able to make out Jupiter's moons. I usually find that I can't hold the binoculars steady enough and I need to rest them on something. So if you've got a tripod or a fence or something you can rest on, then that can help. So that would be nice to see on the 14th. Let's stay with the moon now and have a look at our moon watch challenge for this month. I'm going to go to the 4th of June because that is when the full moon is. I'm just going to go to a bit of a darker part of the night and zoom in. Okay, so you can see we've got a full moon on the 4th of June. Not quite full because we're on the 3rd. There we go. Full moon on the 4th of June. And the thing that I'd like you to have a try at this month is to see if you can observe along the terminator line. So you actually need to observe on a day that isn't full. And I just want you to watch what happens to the moon's terminator over the days following the full moon. So you can see the terminator beginning to change the phase of the moon from full to gibbous. The terminator line being the line between dividing night and day on the moon and representing the region where the sun is either setting or rising. And it's a great place for observing with a telescope or a pair of binoculars, because features that appear along the terminator, such as crater rims or mountains, stand out so much more than they do at other times. They cast dramatic shadows across the surface to let us know that they're there. And the terminator moves by about 12 degrees of longitude every night. So a really fun project that you can do is to pick a feature on the moon. You could pick some mountains or a crater or a system of craters and observe it through the course of the night. You can return every 30 minutes or so and see how it changes. And you can make sketches of that process, or you could take photographs. And I like to do this because I think we tend to think of the moon as being quite static and unchanging. But actually, if we observe around the terminator, we can see significant changes in appearance over small timescales and can really help you to get to know the moon and the features of the moon as well. Let's say goodbye to the moon now and take a look at the summer triangle. And the summer triangle is an asterism. An asterism being an interesting collection of stars that isn't a full constellation. The way to find the summer triangle is to think back to our constellation of the month for last month, which was Lyra, and the bright star in Lyra, which is Vega. So you can see Vega up here. I'll put my mouse on it. It will be roughly in the southeast during the dark part of the night all through the month of June, and it will be the brightest object in that part of the sky, so it shouldn't be too difficult to spot. And the other two bright stars to look out for the summer triangle are Altair in Aquila and Deneb in Cygnus. And to make that easier for you to see, I'm going to pop the constellation lines off and put the asterism lines on. There we go. And you can see that we have the summer triangle. So Vega, Altair and Deneb forming the summer triangle. And it's quite a striking sight to see on a summer's night, to see those three stars forming that triangle. When we think about the summer triangle, it leads us quite nicely onto our constellation of the month, which is Cygnus the Swan, because Cygnus the Swan is the home of Deneb, which is the third star in the summer triangle. And before I take the asterism lines off, I just want to point out this asterism to you, which is the Northern Cross, which is an asterism that appears in the constellation of Cygnus. So I'll take those back off and I'll pop the constellation lines on, and also the art, so you can see Cygnus depicted as a swan. Cygnus means swan in Latin, and it's one of the most recognisable constellations in the summer sky. And there are lots of stories around Cygnus. One of my favourites is a story from Chinese mythology called the Magpie Bridge. And the story tells us of two lovers, a fairy and a mortal, who are separated by the Sky River. And they're reunited once a year when all the magpies of the world fly up into the sky to form a bridge across the river. And if we look really closely, we can see that the Sky River in the story is actually the disk of the Milky Way, or the heart of our home galaxy. I'm just going to take off the art in order for us to see that. And it's really difficult to see. Even on my software, it's difficult to see. But you can hopefully see the Milky Way arching across the sky. If you want to see it for real, you need a really darkest possible location that you can find. If I cheat and take the atmosphere off, then you can see it a lot more clearly. Unfortunately, we can't do that in real life when we're trying to observe. The atmosphere is always getting in the way. Whilst we're in Cygnus the Swan, a great deep sky object to look out for is the double star Alberio. You won't be able to resolve it with a pair of binoculars, so you will need a small telescope to do this. And it's the star that appears right at the head of the swan up here. And I'm just going to zoom in on it. So with your small telescope, you should easily be able to resolve it into one blue and one gold star. And the contrasting colour between those two stars makes this a really wonderful target. So if you've never had a chance to see it before, then I really recommend that you get out with a small telescope if you have one, and see if you can resolve this double star. That brings me to the end of our night sky tour for June 2023. I wish you clear skies for all of your observing this month, and I'll be back next month to talk about what you can see in July.